Hello, good morning, good evening, good afternoon, everybody, wherever you might be. It's my great honor and pleasure to welcome Joachim Kunz aus Münster, and he will tell us about the image of bot periodicity in cyclic homology. Joachim, the floor is yours. Take it away.
Okay, I'm going to talk about something which is not very new, but maybe possibly not quite so well known. And also, I have In the last few weeks or so, I have made an effort to understand the details of the situation in more detail. Okay, but the situation I'm interested in is the comparison between K-theory and cyclic homology, and in particular of the periodicity properties of the two theories. Now, as you all know, there are two fundamental tools for studying the topology of an algebra over the complex numbers. The first one is topological K-theory on the one hand, and on the other hand, periodic cyclic homology. And one of the first striking observations is, of course, the fact that both theories are periodic, Z-mod-2 periodic, and periodic cyclic theory is in an intrinsic way Z2 periodic, that's essentially induced by Kohn's S operator. On the other hand, topological K-theory is Z-mod-2 periodic, but only using a deep result, namely a bot periodicity. So you have the bot periodicity isomorphism. And now these two theories can be defined. There is a Chern-Kohn character, which can be viewed in the monovariant case, but it's even better viewed in the bivariant case. And in the bivariant case, it gives you a multiplicative transformation from the bivariant K theory to the bivariant cyclic periodic homology. And okay, now here it says, which is a candidate for a bivariant Chern-Kohn character? I mean, that will be one of the topics in my talk. I mean, there is a natural candidate for a multiplicative transformation, but which turns out not to be completely the right one, because it is not compatible with the Z-mod-2 periodicity. I mean, so it does not descend, it's multiplicative on a Z-credit theory, but not on the Z-mod-2 periodic theory. So it has to be modified. And that's the topic I'm going to talk about. And in order to do this modification, we have to understand exactly the image of the bot periodicity in cyclic homology. That's the title of the talk. So we want to understand this connection. And so we want to understand the connection between periodicity in K-theory, which is given by a bot map, and on the other hand, by periodicity in cyclic homology, which is given by Kohn's S operator. And so we need this in order to define the correct version of the Chern-Kohn character from Z-mod-2 periodic K-theory to cyclic homology. And so that's the problem I'm going to discuss. And the natural setting, of course, is the bivariant setting. I mean, already because the bot periodicity is given by a product with a bivariant element in the most natural way. And so it's the best way definitely to understand the situation to pass to the bivariant theory. And both theories, K-theory, so topological K-theory and periodic cyclic homology, come naturally in bivariant versions, denoted by little kk star and HP star. So these are the bivariant theories of topological K theory and periodic cyclic homology. And we need to discuss the connection between the two, we need some ingredients. And the first important ingredient is to specify a good category of algebras. And this algebra has to be such that both theories are defined and have reasonable properties. So we could not, for instance, we could not take the category of C-star algebras because there the cyclic homology does not have good properties. But there is there are several categories that could be chosen, and they are basically locally convex algebras. Now, for the purpose of this talk, I will use the simplest choice, which is the category of complete locally convex algebras over the complex numbers. where the topology is defined by submultiplicative seminoids. I mean, this submultiplicativity can be omitted and the entire thing would still work, but it becomes quite a bit more complicated. So I will concentrate on this simplest category, and the natural tensor product in this category is the projective tensor product of two alphas and completed. You also need extensions, of course, because spot periodicity is based on extensions, on excision properties of K theory. I mean, for the proof of spot periodicity, I mean, the natural proofs, you usually need long exact sequences and excision properties of topological K theory. Now, an extension in the category of M alphas is an exact sequence of alphas where the maps are homomorphisms. So you have a quotient map and inclusion map. And we also have to assume that our extensions admit a continuous linear splitting. So there is a map S from the quotient to the alpha in the middle, so that Q circle S is the identity. And so we simply write, we omit the zeros at both ends and simply write I to E to V for such an extension. Now, homotopies, we also have to be careful. We cannot use simply continuous homotopies because periodic cyclic homology and cyclic homology in general is not invariant under any arbitrary continuous homotopies, but the homotopies have to be differentiable. So we simplify a little bit and take the simplest choice, namely we take infinitely differentiable homotopies. And we will use such homotopies. Then we are sure that the cyclic homology will be invariant under such homotopies. So here we need some notation. We given such an M alpha A, we do know it. I mean, that's kind of the standard notation, A of 0, 1 with a square bracket on both sides. These are the differentiable functions on the unit interval with values in A, but we always assume that the derivatives of the functions on both endpoints are zero. All higher derivatives are zero. Hmm? So then we can compose two homotopies. Otherwise, this would not be an equivalence relation. And so we will use such homotopies. And so you see the other alphas of functions are those that vanish at one, or the ones that vanish at both endpoints, and in all cases we want the higher derivatives to vanish at both endpoints, and they should be infinitely differentiable. Okay, and so this gives rise to a notion of homotopy, differentiable homotopy, which I call diffotopy. So two homomorphisms are called differentiably homotopic or diffotopic if there is a homomorphism from phi from A to the functions on the interval with values in B, such that at the point zero, it gives you the first homomorphism. At the point one, it gives you the second homomorphism. And also for K-theory, of course, we need to stabilize by matrices. And the natural choice in this category for us, and again, the simplest choice will be the algebra, which I don't note by script K, of rapidly decreasing matrices of arbitrary size. Okay, I mean, we could also take, for instance, Schatten class operators, but in this talk, I really want to simply restrict to the simplest choices. So that's our notion of stability in this category. And as I told you already, for all the arguments, excision properties and extensions are very important. And we will all the time use the fact that there is a universal extension in this category of M alphas. And this is given by the non-unital tensor alpha. So if A is one of our M alphas, then the tensor alpha is what you might think. I mean, it's just a direct sum of all the tensor powers of A. So non-unital, so there is no copy of the ground field. And this tensor alpha can be completed in a completely natural way using submultiplicative seminorms, extending the seminorms given on A so that it becomes a universal M alpha and which is generated by this image of A here in the first summand under a continuous linear map. So the map from A into here should be continuous. So that gives you a definition of the semi-norms, submultiplicative semi-norms that you have to impose on TA. Now there is a natural surjective map from this tensor alpha to A, and this maps a tensor A1 tensor AN to the product of the AI. And so this map has a kernel, which is an ideal in the tensor alpha, and we denote this kernel by JA. And so we have an extension. I mean, the splitting from A to TA is, of course, the inclusion into the first summand of the tensor alpha. So that's one of the admissible extensions. And in fact, this is a universal extension among all extensions admitting a continuous linear splitting. So just to see that, take an extension, any extension that has a continuous linear split S from A to E, then you get a commutative diagram. You can map the tensor algebra to E using the map S, namely you map the copy of A in the first summand of TA via S, and then then you just multiply on tensors, you just map a tensor A1, tensor and so on, AN to S of A1, tensor S of times S of A2 and so on. So here you have a homomorphism, and it's clear that this here commutes, and then of course this map has to map the ideal here to the ideal here simply by commutativity. And this map here has a special meaning, a special function. So this is called, I call this the classifying map of the extension. And a philosophy is that this classifying map contains all the information you need on the given extension. I mean, it's really an extension, the essence of this extension for us, for topological K-theory and so on, and periodic cyclic homology is the classifying map. So in a way, the extensions are not as important as the classifying map. And so that's the classifying map. And it depends on S only up to smooth homotopy, because if you have two different lifts, S and S prime, then you can connect them by affine linear homotopy. Okay, so probably you know this, but I still have to repeat it. Now we have two versions of a suspension. Namely, we have, first of all, we have the classical suspension, which is here. So the functions on the unit interval with values in A that vanish at both endpoints. And but J of A is also another version of a suspension because, we will see that in a moment. I will argue why this is just another version of a suspension. And now, again, a kind of standard notation. If you have two M algebras, then we denote by A comma B in square brackets the set of diffotopy classes of homomorphisms from the alpha A to the alpha B. And now we have the classifying map gamma A. So we have, besides the universal extension, we have another very important extension, which is the cone extension. So this here is a cone extension. So here you have the cone over A, which is the functions on the unit interval that vanish at the point one, but not necessarily at zero. And here you can map this, you can evaluate at zero and you get a map to A. And the kernel of this consists of the functions that vanish at both endpoints. So this is an extension. And now, as I said on the previous slide, we can compare this extension with the universal extension, and we get a classifying map from JA to the ideal here. So any extension gives you of where you have A as a quotient gives you a map from JA to the ideal. So you have this map gamma A from JA to the ordinary suspension. And now we have this map gamma A. And so when we have a homomorphism from A to B, then we get from gamma A is exactly a homomorphism from JA to A to the suspension of A. And now we can iterate this. And what you might call a suspension stable homotopy. So we take the J suspensions on the left hand side and the ordinary suspensions on the right hand side. And we take higher powers of the suspensions, but for the same K. So we increase the index on both sides just by one. And then we have the maps. We have a map from the Kth object here to the K plus first objects when we use this map up here. So we can take the limit over K when we take when you apply successively gamma on to this thing, we get the index K increases by one, and we can take the inductive limit of this thing. Now, okay, so this is really so KKN is a Z gradient. It's not, I mean, N does not need to be positive. I mean, just use if N is. Or negative. If n is positive, then you emit the first k where k minus n is negative, and you just start with a higher k. I mean, you just look at the inductive limit for k, which is sufficiently large. And so you get one of these kkn a comma b for all n, for every integer n. And now, KK, as you might guess or probably know, this is actually an abelian group. You can make this an abelian group in two ways, which are equivalent. So one possible way is to use the embedding of the algebra K, direct sum K into itself. On the, I mean, if you just double the underlying space, you could also argue, you could also just split suspension in two halves. Anyway, so it is an abelian group in a natural way. I mean, it's just, you know this, of course, from ordinary K-theory and so on. So it's not only an abelian group, but it's also a natural product from the S group to the T times the T group to the S plus T group. So and you go from A1 to A2, and then from A2 to A3, then you get the product from KKS A1, A2 times KKT of A2, A3 to KKS plus T, A1 times A3. And well, I mean, this is really quite simple, but I don't want to write it down because when you write it down, it looks a little bit more complicated. But what you do is you have a homomorphism from this suspension, higher suspension to this higher suspension. And then you want to compose this with a map from another higher suspension to another higher suspension. And so in order to compose these maps, you just stabilize by suspension. So you stabilize the second, you stabilize maybe the first one so that it is compatible with the higher suspension that you have here. And in so far that you can compose the two, and then you have to permute the J suspension with the with the ordinary suspension, and then you get a map from the higher J suspension to a higher ordinary suspension from on A3. I mean, more about this? I mean, just think of the fact that you have just one J and one zero one here, one J, just zero one. Then you stabilize one by J on both sides, and you can compose it with the second one, and then you have to switch the J suspension with the ordinary suspension. I mean, it's pretty straightforward, but a little bit inconvenient to write it down. Now, when you have a homomorphism alpha from A to B, then you get an element KK alpha and KK zero from A comma B, obviously, because the maps from A to B is just the lowest level of this inductive limit. So, I mean, in the inductive limit, you start with the homomorphism from A to B and then stabilize with the map gamma A and so on. And And so you get an element in KT0 from A, B. And this map where you associate the homomorphism alpha, the element KT alpha in KT0 from A, B, this is multiplicative. Okay, so you can view it. You can view, as you probably also all know, you can view KK0 as a category where the objects are M alphas and where KK0 from AB is are the morphisms in this category. And of course, what? This product here from KKS times KKT to KKS plus T specializes to a product from KK0 times KK0 to KK0. So that's the category. Okay, now it is not very difficult to see that this functor KK to KK0 AB, this is a universal functor into an additive category, which is difotopy invariant, stable, and split exact in both variables. Namely, if you have any functor E from the category of M alphas to an additive category which has these properties, it's difotopy invariant, stable, and split exact in both variables. Let's rather say half exact. Maybe it would be easier, better to say half exact here in this case. Let's say half exact. Then there's a unique functor F from this category KK0, which we just have seen on the previous slide, to the given additive category C, such that the functor E is just the composition of the functor F with the standard functor little kk, which goes from the alpha category of M alphas to the category kk0. Now, the proof is really very simple. Here I've written a half exactness, so you should definitely replace split exact by half exact here for the argument. So the properties of half exactness and homotopy invariance imply that any extension of the form I goes is an ideal in A, and the quotient is B of M alphas induces long exact sequences under E in both variables. I mean, that comes from the half exactness and the homotopy invariance. And we can apply these long exact sequences in particular to the standard extensions that we have already seen, namely JA goes to the sensor alpha goes to A, and from the ordinary suspension to the cone over A to A, and both of these extensions have the property that the alpha in the middle, namely TA, is contractible. I mean, even differentiably contractible, and this cone is also differentiably contractible. So by homotopy invariance, when you apply E to these things in both variables, you get zero. So whenever you plug in one of these contractible alphas in E, then you get zero. So we write E of AB for the image under E of the morphisms M alpha morphisms from A to B. And so the image in the morphism in the category C. So simply write E of AB for this image. And now, as I said, I've already said this, E applied to contractible alphas T and A01 gives always zero in both variables of this E of AB. And but this shows when you look at the exact sequences, in the exact sequences for the first thing, you get a long exact sequence that connects JA and A. So you get a map from A to JA, so you get it actually, the JA becomes up to a dimension shift isomorphic under E to A in the same way B of 0, 1, because the alpha in the middle is contractible, becomes under E up to a dimension shift isomorphic under E isomorphic to B. So you can replace this B of 0, 1 by B up to a dimension shift. And if you do it in both variables at the same time, there's no dimension shift anymore. And so you get naturally from the contractibility of these alphas in the middle and the long exact sequences, you get this isomorphism that E of JA, B of 0, 1 is isomorphic to E of AB. And then, of course, we can iterate this, and then we get E of J n A, B of 0, 1, n. The n-fold suspensions is isomorphic to E of AB. And then we can also, in the second variable, we can stabilize by the compact operators. And now we can take an element x in KK0 of AB. Well, an element x in KK0 of AB is represented as by definition by a homomorphism from the n-fold suspension of A to the n-fold suspension of B tensored with the compact operators. And that's just the definition of KK0. And then we can, of course, map this x, the element x, which is defined by phi. We can put f of x equals e of phi. I mean, this will not depend on the choice of phi because e is homotopy invariant, right? I mean, we can take any phi representing x, any homomorphism in phi, because we take the homotopy classes. And so the e of phi will not depend on the choice of phi, and we can define f of x as e of phi, and this is an element of this image under E of the morphism from K and A to K tensor B of 0, 1. But as we have seen, this E of this higher suspension is isomorphic to E of AB. So you get F, and this is, of course, the functor F that we are looking for. It associates to an element X, the element in this in E of AB. It obviously has the required properties, namely that E is F composition with KK, and that's just by definition. Okay, so that's already a good start in order to define a bivariant Chern-Kohn character from bivariant KK star to bivariant HP star, because bivariant HP star has these properties that we have just seen in this universality theorem. I mean, it is stable, it's diffeotopy invariant, and half exact. So HPS is half exact, stable, and diffeotopy invariant in both variables. So we get a multiplicative map from KK0 to HP0, right? Because so HP0 has these properties. So we get a multiplicative map from KK0 to HP0. Now we really want not only a map from KK0 to HP0, but we want a map from the, in the first step, we want a map from the Z-graded theory KK star to, let's say, the Z-graded HP star, but which is automatically a Z-mod-2-graded because by the intrinsic periodicity of periodic cyclic homology. And so we want to extend this from KK0 to arbitrary KKS. And we use the long exact sequences. Again, we use the standard extensions by the tensor algebra and the Kohn extension. And the fact that the tensor algebra and the Kohn over A are contractible shows that there are invertible elements. The first element for each A, we have an element alpha A in HP1 of A, JA. And we have an element beta A in HP1 of A, of the suspension of A, A, with the following property. I'll tell you in a moment how we get the alpha A and the beta A. Let me first tell you the property. So the property of these maps is that the boundary map in the long exact sequence induced by the tensor alpha extension of A in the first variable of HP of the bivariant HP star. Here should be a comma. In the first variable of HP star dot comma B is given by the product on the left by alpha of A. Now, how do we get this element alpha of A? Very easily. Namely, the boundary, it's a standard fact which follows more or less from abstract nonsense, that the boundary maps in HP star as well as in KK star are given by the elements induced by the classifying map. So we have So we have the extension by the tensor alpha, and there is a classifying map from JA to JA, if you like, but this defines in, no, sorry. No, sorry, we plug the tensor algebra in one of the variable, in the first variable. Okay, and we have a B in the second variable, which is fixed. And then we get a long exact sequence in the first variable. And more or less by standard abstract nonsense, the boundary map in this long exact sequence in the first variable is given by the product with the element of KK minus, that should be HP minus of A, comma A, defined by the classifying map. It should not. Okay, there's two misprints here. So that should be HP minus of A, comma A, defined by the classifying map. So we have the classifying map. And then HP star is a functor. When you have a homomorphism from an algebra to an algebra, it gives you an element in HP star from the same algebra to the same algebra. And so you take the classifying map. And when you take this element of HP minus A, comma A, defined by the classifying map, then it gives you exactly the boundary map in the long exact sequence in the first variable, if you fix the second variable as B. Now, there's a second element, beta A, and this beta A is again, comes from a classifying map. It's the boundary map in the sequence in the second variable of HP star B comma A is induced by the cone extension is given by the product of beta A to the minus one on the right. Okay, again, the beta A to the minus beta A is the map induced by the classifying map. And and beta A to the minus one is beta A to the minus one is comes from the classifying map, and this gives you an invertible element because in the cone extension the alpha in the middle is contractible, and so beta A we take the inverse of this map, of this element. So we take the inverse of this invertible element. Anyway, so I mean it's it follows from this yoga very simply of using universal extensions and boundary maps that you have these elements. So of course we can iterate this. So we get invertible elements alpha A to the N. So take higher and higher J on the right and higher suspensions on the left. And then we get invertible elements alpha A to the N in HPN of A comma JN of A and beta A to the N HPN A of 0, 1, comma A. And now we want to use these elements in order to define a transformation from KK star to HP star. And so take an element X in KKS of A comma B. It's always represented by a homomorphism from a J suspension, so the N minus first J suspension of A to an ordinary suspension of B. And then we can set, we can first apply HP0, so HP0 to this homomorphism phi. This is an element of the bivariant HP0 from this J suspension to this ordinary suspension. But then we multiply it on the left by this invertible element alpha A to the N minus S and on the right by beta B to the N. I mean, the idea is that this alpha A to the N minus S kills this suspension and it connects this J N minus S of A with A itself. So when you multiply this by this element alpha A to the N minus S on the left, we go from this suspension J N minus S of A to A itself under HP. In the same way, when we multiply by beta P to the N, then we go from the suspension, the n-fold suspension of B to B itself by multiplying it under HP star. So So it's like kind of conjugation by isomorphisms, and multiplication by beta b is an isomorphism, multiplication by alpha a is an isomorphism. And I mean, the beta b is not exactly the inverse of alpha a, or let's say or of alpha b, but nearly. I mean, they, when you multiply, when you go first beta b and then alpha a, then you get the map gamma that we had before, which is basically just the identity on these things. Okay, so that we can set this like this. And we can also stabilize by, we should stabilize by k in the second variable, but this really makes no difference because then we just stabilize under HP star and we get an isomorphism. And okay, so if you want to check this gives you a multiplicative transformation from KKS, from the Z-graded KKS to HPS, we have to take the product of two such things like such as phi and another psi, and then we have to multiply what we got here for phi and for psi, and then we see that the beta b basically cancels to the alpha b. So we have three alphas a, b, and c, let's say. And so in the middle we have beta b, then is it here's an alpha b, and at the end is some beta c, and basically the beta p cancels. I mean, it's not the inverse of alpha b, but nearly up to gamma. I mean, the gamma is the identity on these things anyway. So it's pretty clear that this is actually multiplicative. So it's a multiplicative map from the Z-graded theory KK star. So it has the property that chi, we call this transformation chi, because that's what I told you before is the possible candidate for a Chern-Korn character, which is not yet the correct one we are looking for, but you get, so we call it chi, so it gives you a transformation chi s from KKS to HPS, and it's multiplicative, so when you multiply it, here this should be x times y. Okay, I mean, this page has really many misprints, I'm sorry. So before I sending the slides to you, Piotr, I will correct the misprints on this page.
Yeah, thank you, okay. I appreciate it, yes, thanks. Huh? Yeah, I appreciate it, yes.
Okay, I do that. So this here should be read chi s plus t of x times y is the same as chi s of x times chi t of y in HP s plus t of a comma c. And okay, so I mean, just to say, I mean, probably you don't follow all the formulas anyway, but this is really not difficult to see that this map is multiplicative. I mean, it's just arranged in such a way that it's multiplicative. Okay. That's something. Okay, now we come to Bott periodicity. Now there are various proofs of Bott periodicity, a proof by Atiyah, a proof by Kasparov. There's also a proof by myself. And all these proofs use explicitly or implicitly an index map. Now, and there is a universal model. I mean, we work a lot with universal models. A universal model for an index map is given by the Toeplitz extension. So you can define the Toeplitz extension completely algebraically. So algebraically, the Toeplitz algebra over the field of complex numbers is a universal unital algebra Tor here, generated by two elements U and V, satisfying the relation V times U is equal to one. I mean, in the case of C-star algebras, you would take V as U star, but the general thing is V times U is equal to one. And then you can check. It's a very easy check algebraically that when you look at the ideal generated by the defect projection, 1 minus uv, so the condition is v times u is 1, but so when you look at, but uv is of course not equal to 1, but you can look at 1 minus uv, and that's idempotent, And when you look at the ideal generated by this idempotent, then it's isomorphic to the algebra of finite matrices of arbitrary size over the complex numbers. And the quotient by this ideal is isomorphic to the algebra of Laurent polynomials, where, of course, u goes to z and v goes to z minus 1. Now, there is a really simple algebraic argument in connection with Bode periodicity that goes back to an old article of mine that shows that the natural inclusion of the complex numbers as complex numbers times a unit in tau induces an isomorphism from e to c, e of c to e of tau for every homotopy invariant. And here we just need, if you want to do it algebraically, polynomial homotopies, homotopy functor, homotopy invariant functor, which is also split exact and matrix stable, so it doesn't change if you stabilize by matrices, and it's also split exact for exact split it respects split exact extensions. And so for all these, any such functor, the tau is basically contractible under E, namely you can contract it just to the multiples of the unit, so the just a copy of the complex numbers. Okay, if we have that, then of course we can look at the subalgebra of tau, which is the kernel of the natural map from tau to the complex numbers, where you map the V and U to one. And then E of tau zero is zero, because under this contraction, the tau zero becomes zero. And this is a completely algebraic argument, and it's very simple and general. So it carries over to all reasonable completions of tau. In the original article, it was done for sister algebras, but you can do it for other completions. In particular, you can do it for M algebra completions. So when we can complete tau, this algebraic topless algebra, as a to a M algebra, there's a very natural M algebra completion. And so we call this natural M algebra completion T, script T, and T zero for the corresponding completion of tau zero. And then the Laurent polynomials get completed to the C infinity functions on the circle. And here in the middle, we have this completed Toeplitz algebra and the algebra of finite matrices of arbitrary size becomes the right choice of the completion becomes the algebra K of rapidly decreasing matrices. And here the algebra T zero will map to the functions on the circle, C infinity functions on the circle that vanish at one, at the point one. And by the argument that I just described or mentioned, so we know that T zero is basically contractible, I mean, up to stabilization and adding on something. And so this shows in particular that under KK zero, KK star, so KK star is a stable homotopy invariant and half exact. So if we plug in T zero, or if, even if we simply tensor any algebra by T zero in the first variable and second variable, we always get zero because T zero is like a contractible algebra from this simple general argument. So T zero is like a contractible algebra. It's KK contractible if you wish. Unfortunately, I cannot read the first line here because it's hidden by something, maybe something that belongs to Zoom. But but I can guess. I have to guess what's in the first line. So what does Bode periodicity mean for KK star? I mean, the KK star that we have constructed is just a Z-graded. So if you want to have Bode periodicity for KK star, it means that KK star plus 2 is equal to KK star, or equal to KK star minus 2. So it means that KKN minus 2 of A comma B is one way to describe KKN minus 2 is just to stabilize the first variable 2 times by the non-commutative suspension J2. So that's KKN of J2 comma A of A comma B is KKN minus 2 of A comma B. And so we want this to be equal isomorphic to KKN of A comma B. So that's what periodicity, one way to see what periodicity. It's equivalent to have an element in it's to say that KKN plus 2, which is the twofold ordinary suspension in the second variable, so A comma twofold suspension in the second variable is isomorphic to KKN of A comma B. So on the second suspension of B. Okay, anyway, if you like, there are two invertible elements. Board periodicity means that there's a board invertible element here from J to A to B. And there is an inverse which goes from A to twofold suspension of A. Okay, anyway, so now I come back to something I mentioned already and used already. So if you have any extension of M alpha, where the alpha D in the middle is equivalent to zero in KK zero, then you have the long exact sequences in KK zero. And as I told you, the boundary map, the long exact sequence, is given by the product with the element classifying, given by the classifying map in KK minus of Q comma I. And since the boundary map has to be an isomorphism because the alpha in the middle is contractible, this gives you an invertible element. This element has to be invertible. So the element coming from the classifying map from J Q to I, this is an element KK minus 1 of Q comma I. This has to be invertible if the alpha in the middle is contractible. Now, we have two extensions of the type. Now, we had already two, but here now we have an additional extension, namely the Toeplitz extension. So before we had the universal extension and the cone extension. Now, here we use the cone extension again, but we also use this Toeplitz extension with the algebra T0. We have seen that the algebra in the middle is equivalent to zero in KK. So again, this extension gives you an invertible element in KK minus of the algebra on the right and K tensor A. Now, when we take the product, so we get two elements in KK minus, so an element in KK minus of A comma A. So we have two elements in KK minus of A comma A, one coming from this extension, one coming from this extension. We can take the product. I mean, KK star has a product. And so that gives you a map in KK minus 2 of A comma A. And this is represented by the map from J2 of A to K tensor A, which is given as a composition of several maps. First, we take the classifying map for the second extension, the cone extension. So that gives you a map from JA to A of 0, 1. Then, okay, now have a look here. This is the suspension of A of 0, 1. Now, here you have the functions on the circle with values in A that vanish at 1. I mean, this is not the same as the suspension. I mean, for this algebra, of course, these two suspensions are the same. But here you have to be careful. I mean, these are just the functions that vanish at 1. But this is kind of equivalent. So what we can do anyway is we can embed this algebra, suspension algebra, the function vanishing at both endpoints, in the functions on the circle with values on A that vanish at 1. I mean, it's just an embedding. So we can use this embedding in here. So the embedding from a suspension of A into the functions on the circle with values on A. And finally, we can compose it with a classifying map for the triplets extension. So that gives you a map from J of this alpha C infinity of S1, A to K tensor A. And this gives you an invertible element in KT minus 2 of A, A. So we get a map from J2 of A to K tensor A, which we get by the composition of all these maps. And this gives you an invertible element in KT minus 2 of A, A. Well, first of all, these the elements that we compose, I mean, the first two, the elements coming from the extensions are invertible by what we said, because the alpha in the middle is contractible. But the inclusion J is also invertible, because you can there's a homotopy between the functions on the circle vanishing at one and the functions on the interval with values in A vanishing at both endpoints. Okay, so I mean it's that's also I mean the inclusion J is also an invertible element. And so all together, if you get an invertible element in KK minus 2 of A, A. And so that's the fundamental element that governs Bode periodicity. And in fact, Bode periodicity will be the product by this element in KK minus 2 A, A. And that has been used in many places. I mean, for instance, first of all, in my old article, also in an article by Nistor on the bivariant joint contact, in an article by Fuschnick and so on. I mean, that, in bivariant discussions of Bode periodicity, it comes up in many places. Okay, we denote, we give this element a name, we call it the BA, the spot element BA. This is an invertible element in KK minus 2 A, A. And it's given, as I explained, by the map from J2 of A to K tensor A as above. Okay, now we want to see, we have this transformation from KK star to HP star, which is multiplicative. We want to see, so that the transformation was called chi, right? So we want to see what happens to the spot element in KK minus 2 of A, A in HP minus 2 A, A. So that's the next step to look at. And in fact, one can do a computation. In fact, the computation in this theorem has been appears for the first time maybe in an article by Nistor. So we can compute the image under chi minus 2 of the Bode element over the complex numbers, right? I mean, okay, the computation is really not so difficult. It's just a small exercise in homological algebra. Namely, first we have to see what is the image of BC under chi minus 2. Okay, I mean, so the chi minus 2, so the BC is a composition of two boundary maps and this inclusion map. Okay, so we have two boundary maps. We start with the element 1C, which is the identity element and HP star of C comma C. So 1C is shorthand for the identity image of the identity of C in HP star of C comma C in the bivariant C. And then we apply first the boundary map under the Cohen extension to this thing. So the Cohen extension goes from C of 0, 1 to the Cohen over C to C. And so we look at the boundary map that gives you in the second variable that goes and we apply it to the element 1C. So by the extent, so this. Then we have to embed C of 0, 1 into the functions on the circle. And then we have to apply to the image of this, we have to apply the boundary map for the triplets extension. And we have to compute the boundary maps in HP star. Now HP star is defined by a complex. And if you want to compute the boundary map in the long exact sequences of HP star, I mean, that's a long exact sequence given by a quotient of complexes. So we have to, in order to do the computation, we use some homological algebra. So HP star is defined by a chain complex. And in fact, in rather than this bivariant HP star, so we fix the first variable to be the complex numbers in the bivariant series. So we just argue on the second variable, but HP star of C comma A is just the monovariant HP star of A. So it's just a monovariant computation. So we have to start, so the one here really corresponds to HP to one here. And then we have to look at the boundary maps in the just the ordinary HP star of the second variable. And now the algebras that are involved are really very simple. Namely, we have these algebras, C of 0, 1, C of 0, 1, and C. We have the complex, the compact operators. We have the completed tensor algebra. And we have the functions on the circle. All these algebras have a very small homological dimension. In fact, some of the ideals are even H unital. I mean, we don't need this because we can use for HP star, we can use the general result on an excision that HP star uses excision. But I mean, we could also mention that these algebras are H units, so even in ordinary cyclic homology, we get long exact sequences and we can compute the boundary map. But also they have small homological dimension, so they are basically nearly quasi free, all these algebras. And so looking into the situation shows that you can just do the computation on a very small, on a much smaller complex, not a B minus B complex, which determines HP star. But we can work even in a much smaller complex, what we call the X complex, which is just goes from A, then you have the universal derivation into omega 1 of A, followed by the quotient by commutators. So the natural sign, natural stands here for the quotient by commutators. And in the other direction, you have the B operator, which maps X dy to the commutator of X and Y. So that's the B operator. So it's a very small complex, and this complex suffices to do the computation also for the boundary maps. And so we have to look to check the boundary map for this quotient. So we have and we want to look at the image of 1C under the boundary maps. So we take 1C. So we have to lift it. We have to lift it in this extension to an element here, to a function here. Usually the easiest would be just to take the function t, the identity function, but this does not quite fit because c of 0, 1 are the functions that vanish with all derivatives at 0, but there is a standard function h which is monotone and increasing if it is positive and starts with 0 and ends up with 1, and the derivatives as 1 are also vanishing. And so call this function h, so we choose such a monotone function. And we lift 1 to this function n, and then we have to apply the boundary operator, natural d. And so when we apply the boundary operator to this function, we get the dh, and then image in the quotient by commutators. And then we embed c of 0, 1 in c infinity of s1. So we have a dh. And in C infinity of S1, we have the element e to the 2 pi I h, which is unitary, which I call W here. And then, of course, if you divide by commutators, then you see immediately that the element, the standard element W minus 1 dW, is the same as dH if you divide by commutators. So when we embed these functions in the functions on the circle, then the image of dH modulo commutators is just this element W minus dW. And then So you have this, we get this element here on the right hand side, and then we have to apply the operator B, which maps W minus 1 dW to the commutator of then we have to lift W and W minus 1 to elements, and the natural lifts are of course U and V. So we lift W to U, and we lift W minus 1 to V, and then we have to apply the boundary operator B. So we lift the W minus 1 dW to V times dU modulo commutators, and then we apply the operator B, and we get the commutator of V and U, so VU minus UV, but that was exactly our defect idempotent E in the compact operators. And that's of course the identity in HP star. So I mean, modulo stabilization, that's just one. So what's
that was a crucial point missing again. Okay, and that's a really serious misprint. When we look at W minus 1 dW, we do not get dH, but we get 2 pi I dH. I mean, you have to look at dW, which you have to take the derivatives, you get 2 pi I times e to the pi, 2 pi I times h, and so you get not dH, so you get h times 2 pi I times times 1, and so that, okay, that's so so that should be a 2 pi I here. So that's a really crucial point. So it does not correspond to this element, but to 2 pi I, this element, or this element corresponds to 2 pi I dH, right? Okay, sorry, I mean, that's really crucial misprint. So, okay, I mean, I have to check this. Yeah. So, I mean, just the theorem tells you that we get 2 pi I times 1c. So there has to be a 2 pi I, and the 2 pi I is really the crucial point. And I mean, already Alain, in his first foundational paper on cyclic homology, introduced the S operator as 2 pi I times the natural S operator, which nowadays we use the natural S operator, but he had used the 2 pi I times, and that's kind of prophetic because the 2 pi I comes up. And you will see in the sequel also that you could also define the S operator using 2 pi I, and also get kind of a compatible choice. Okay, I'm sorry about this. So there should be a 2 pi I here as a crucial point where you compare the dH with the W minus 1 dW. There should be a 2 pi I in this. Okay, sorry. So the previous theorem gave you the result for the algebra A equals to complex numbers. Mm-hmm. But now from this, you can deduce the same result for any algebra just by exterior product. So when you take any algebra, then we get and it takes the exterior product by the identity element ETA and HP star of A comma A, then you get this by the same computation that chi minus 2 of BA is 2 pi I times 1A. Okay, in fact, I mentioned already that the ideas that come up in this computation are exponential. So in fact, you could do a little bit more precise computation and show this is 2 pi I times 1, but if you do a more precise computation, in fact, Nistor found that BA corresponds, in fact, to 2 pi I times the S operator. So we have this invertible element BA, and if in the group KKN AB, we multiply on the left by this element BA and KK n minus 2 of A comma A, then we get the Bott isomorphism. And So this is the Bott isomorphism from KKN A comma B, and it's isomorphic to KKN minus 2 A comma B, and that's okay. I mean, if you check all, as I told you, the various proofs, there's Bott paricity. If you check that the Bott paricity in the various proofs corresponds, yeah, I mean, it's not always so easy to see, but it always corresponds to this product implicitly. So we had already constructed this map chi, which is multiplicative transformation from the Z-graded KKN to HPN. And now on KKN, we have this two periodicity given by multiplication by the Bott element. Now we have to check what happens to this periodicity when we apply chi. And in order to do this, of course, we exactly have to compute chi n minus 2 of the product in terms of chi n of x. But this is exactly what we have just done in the previous corollary and the theorem. This has been achieved in the theorem, and the answer is chi n minus 2 of b a times x is 2 pi I times chi n of x. And that's exactly the computation in the corollary. Yeah. So what can we do? We can modify our chi, and now this should be the better choice for the Chern-Kohn character. We put, but first of all, we do this only for even n. So we define chi CH minus 2n of phi is 2 pi I to the power n of chi minus 2n phi for homomorphism representing an element in KKN minus 2 of A comma B. And then we get a multiple, so this will still be multiplicative because the two powers of n here are multiplicative. So we get a map from KK 2 star of A comma B to HP star of A comma B, and that map now descends to a transformation from the even KK. So we in topological K theory, usually one identifies KKN minus 2 with KKN using this Bott isomorphism. So when we do this definition for the Chern-Kohn character, then this is compatible with this isomorphism, and therefore it descends to a transformation from the KK star made Z2 periodic. So if we do this identification of KKN with KKN minus 2, and this is compatible with this formula. So we get a map from the even KK to HP even. This comes from the KK2N, but with this identification from the Bott map. And we get this transformation from the Z-mod 2 periodic theory, K theory, even K theory to the even HP star. So that's a good candidate for the Chern-Kohn character in the even case. Okay.
Sorry, Joachim, could you allow me to ask a stupid question? Just yeah. Go back. Yeah. So BA is invertible, yeah. Right?
Yes.
So I can apply chi 2 to the inverse of BA, and then I get simply 1 over 2 pi I, right?
Yeah, that's right, yes. Exactly. Okay,
just to make sure I'm on the right page.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay. Now we come to the odd KK star. I mean, okay, here there is an additional problem. So we have constructed the Chern-Kohn character CH from the even part of KK star made set 2 periodic to H bar K star, and such that it is multiplicative and descends to K star. But now we want to extend this to the odd part. So if we assume chi k minus 1 is the thing that we have extended, and we require it to be multiplicative, this would mean in particular that CH minus 1 of X CH times minus 1 of Y should be CH minus 2 of X times Y. But we have already seen that CH minus 2 of X times Y is 2 pi I times chi of minus 2 of X times Y. And that's the computation we just did. So if we choose X and Y in KK minus 1, then for CH minus 2 of XY, we should get 2 pi I chi of minus 2 of XY. And now if you think about this, and I mean, there is really no other solution. If you want to make the CH multiplicative also on the odd part, but to take a square root of 2 pi I, I mean, unfortunately, the square root of 2 pi I is not canonical, but you have to choose one square root of 2 pi I once and for all. And then we can define the bivariant Jankon character by CHN of X by 2 pi I to the minus n and taking square root of chi n of x. And this is now, and then it's easy to check that this is then multiplicative. I mean, so we had an explicit formula for the CH, namely we had these maps, these invertible elements alpha A and beta B. And so the formula for the CH, given a map phi from the J suspension to the B suspension, representing an element in KKN is CCHN of X. That should be 2 pi I to the minus n over 2 times these alpha elements times the image of phi under the functor HP0 in the pi variant theory times the beta elements. Okay, again, I omit the stabilization. I mean, the stabilization would just make the formula a little bit more complicated, but it doesn't change anything. Okay, so I've thought about this, and I think there's really no way around choosing a square root of 2 pi I. I mean, and so we simply have to do this, but then it becomes multiplicative. So we get a transformation, CH star, which extends the previous definition that we had for even n to the case of odd n, and this is multiplicative. It satisfies CHS of X times CHT of Y is CHS plus T of XY, and it descends to a multiplicative transformation from the even KK, even odd, from the KK made Z2 periodic. So KK made Z2 periodic is the KK star, the Z gradient KK star, with the identification by the bot maps. So to get a Z2 periodic theory. And so we get a multiplicative transformation from the Z mod 2 gradient KK to the Z mod 2 gradient HP star. And so we get really a Kon character from the bivariant even odd KK to the bivariant HP star. We are in the first for KK, we have made the identifications coming from the Bott isomorphism. Okay, so this is what we get. Now, let me discuss I guess I have 10 minutes or so.
Oh, you have 17 minutes.
Yeah, okay. It's nearly the end. Now, some considerations at the end. Look at this extension from I is the ideal, A is the alpha in the middle, and B is the quotient. And this gives you an element in KK minus 1 of B, I from the classifying map. And the boundary maps in the exact sequences for KK star and HP star are given as a product by X and chi of X, respectively. I mean, that's something I had mentioned already several times. And since chi is multiplicative, it respects the boundary maps. I mean, the boundary maps are given as a product. So chi respects the boundary maps, right? But this is not quite true for the Chan-Kohn character. Chan-Kohn character has CH minus 1 of x is square root of 2 pi I chi of minus 1 of x. That means that CH star does not respect the boundary maps, but for long exact sequences, it multiplies the boundary maps by square root of 2 pi I minus. There's no other choice, right? Mm-hmm. So in that way, it's not quite as good as chi, but okay, but it has the virtue that it descends to a transformation, to a multiplicative transformation from KK star made to set 2 periodic. Okay, now there's another way to obtain the CH star. Namely, we can define a new theory, HP star bar, where we modify the boundary map in the complex, where the boundary operator is capital B minus little b, the complex defining HP star. We multiply the boundary map in this complex by square root of 2 pi I. I mean, okay, we get a new complex defining a new theory, which we call HP bar. I mean, this is it's not a big change because the image, the kernel and the image of the capital B minus B remain unchanged. If we multiply capital B minus little b by an non-zero number such as square root of 2 pi I. Okay, so the HP bar is really not only isomorphic to HP star. HP bar star is not only isomorphic to HP star, but it's even equal because the kernel and image are exactly the same, right? Mm-hmm. Now, the difference lies in the boundary maps for long exact sequences. If you construct a boundary map in homology for long exact sequence, I mean, first step, you get an exact sequence of complexes. And then from the exact sequence of complexes, you construct a long exact sequence in homology or cohomology. And in this long exact sequence, you use the boundary maps. I mean, you do what I just did before, namely you take an element, you lift it to the complex in the middle, and then you apply the boundary map. Now the boundary map, we have modified the boundary map by multiplying it by square root of 2 pi I. But this, so that means the boundary maps in this new theory, HP bar, are multiplied by square root of 2 pi I. Now we have just as the transformation chi that we had from KK star to HP star, we get a transformation chi bar from KK star to HP bar. And we can define it in complete analogy to chi star. We can define maps alpha n and beta. We can modify the maps alpha n and beta n used for the definition of chi using the boundary maps in the new complex where we have modified the boundary operator capital B minus B to square root 2 pi I times capital B minus B. And then we obtain analogs of the elements alpha and beta that we had before that we call now alpha bar and beta bar. And these, if you look at the formula, they get, of course, multiplied by square root by 2 pi I to the n over 2 and 2 pi I to the minus n over 2. Okay, so that comes out automatically in the formula for the transformation chi bar. Thus, there is a natural choice to define the chi bar as a transformation, as a multiplicative transformation from KK star to HP bar. Then chi bar has all the required properties. It is multiplicative. From the set graded theory, it is compatible with the boundary maps because it's compatible with the product. It's also compatible with the boundary maps. And it descends to a multiplicative transformation from KK star. When we make it set 2 periodic, so when we make the identifications using the Bott isomorphism to HP bar star. In fact, when we identify, as I said, above HP bar with HP, then this chi bar is the same as the Chan-Kohn character that I defined more artificially before, namely just by multiplying it by powers of 2 pi I or half powers of 2 pi I. So I mean, that's another way to construct the character CH star, to modify the complex defining HP to get HP bar, and then to do the completely natural transformation from the Z credit KK star to the Z credit HP bar, and then you get something which is multiplicative, respects the boundary maps, and is transfer this descends to a Z mod 2 credit theory. And okay, so that would be an alternative description of the trend of the bivariant trunk character. So I guess that's it. I have some references, but you can look at this later.
Okay, thank you very much. We have the icon for clapping hands. Right, so now let's start our discussions. Who would like to, I see Jonathan, you have your hand raised. Please go ahead.
Sure, so this is a slash between a question and a comment. Yes. So one thing which I find very nice about this talk that you just gave, Joachim, is that I think it kind of explains something which has always mystified me, which is that the periodicity of HP, the Z mod 2 periodicity, is something which is sort of intrinsic to the theory and works over any field of characteristic zero.
Yes.
But the periodicity of K-theory, on the other hand, is something which depends on the field. So complex K-theory is Z mod 2 periodic, but yes. Real K-theory, let's say if you invert 2, is 4 periodic. So the question is, where does that 4 come from and how is it related to the 2? And I think you've answered the question, because when you look at this churn character, what happens in KK minus 2, you pick up a 2 pi I, which does not descend over from the complexes to the reals. But when you do it twice, then you get a real number. So in other words, for real K theory, it seems that you do get a, if you're working over the reals, you would get this, Conchern character, but only with a 4 periodicity, not a 2 periodicity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a good comment. Yeah.
But isn't the periodicity of real K theory modulo 8, not 4?
Well, yes, but the if you invert 2, it's 4 periodic. The 8 comes from the 2 torsion. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't show up here when you look at little KK.
Okay. Okay, anybody else? Questions / comments? Tomek, you raise your hand. Show yourself, please. Yes.
Well, I have a trivial comment. It's not only the square root of I that is non-canonical, but I itself is non-canonical, I guess. I think I surely just as much.
I itself, yeah. You could also take minus I. You're right.
Yes. Thank you.
I should also mention that there are some signs around which in these boundary maps, some in the boundary, you have some minus signs, so which are not okay. I mean, in the literature, it's a little bit of a mess with the minus signs and so on. But anyway, but okay. But I think I got the minus signs here, right?
Okay, Tomek, was it my impression that you raised your hand? Unmute. Yes.
I raised my hand. So my question is maybe somehow related to these problems with non-canonicity of this square root or something. Namely, in mathematics, there are many twists of this sort. For instance, a Tate twist in et al. Cohomology. And then it comes from something which is called the periodic cyclotomic character. Is this twist here somehow related to some analog of this?
I think it's related to the Maslow index. I mean, it's
Maslow index.
Yeah, I couldn't tell you, but maybe Alan.
I don't know.
If Alan could expand, it would be very.
But I think there is a very interesting issue. Indeed, there is another place where this square root of I enters, and it is a Maslow index. And it has to do with H1. So, I mean, it would be great to find a precise relation, which I don't know. I mean, with this other choice of the square root of I, which enters very naturally in symplectic geometry. There is another point which is important, I mean, which was in fact related to the original choice, which is that the fact that pi is transcendental helps you, for instance, this was done by Jean-Louis Laudet, to show that there is no map which has non-zero degree from the two torus to the sphere, to the two sphere, which is given by Laurent polynomials.
Yes.
This was his thesis, right?
Yeah, I think this was the thesis.
He was always very proud of it. I remember.
Sure.
He loved it.
Extremely good reasons to be proud. But
yeah,
it's exactly related to this factor of 2 pi i.
Okay. Alain, do you want to continue? Any comments, questions?
Adam has a question.
Okay, Adam. Go ahead, Adam.
Yes, this could be a very basic question, but could you please say something more about how this completion of the Teplitz algebra is defined, this completion to the M algebra?
Yeah, okay. I mean, the only little tricky point is that we want the ideal to be the rapidly decreasing matrices in the compact operators. So you have, in the first step, you could just take, universal kind of all submultiplicative seminorms. To write it down is it's easy, but you also have to take. It's too hard to say with words. I guess you need some formulas. I mean, you want to.
Maybe it is in one of the papers which you.
It's nothing difficult or deep. If you sit down, you see it's natural seminorms. Which are submultiplicative. If you see when you want to define the C infinity functions as a completion of the polynomials using submultiplicative seminorms, there's a natural choice. You also have to use the derivatives, and you can do something similar. You have to take derivations on the compact operators and then take submultiplicative seminorms, but also allow derivations. So you compose these submultiplicative seminorms with the derivations and so on. It's not difficult, but it's a little bit hard to say with words, I guess. Mm-hmm. You should think of the example of completing polynomials on the interval to get these infinity functions. How you do that with submultiplicative seminorms, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. And just maybe one additional question related to this. Does it also work in the case of the group algebras? So is there any construction of the completion to the M algebra of the group algebra?
Oh yeah, of course, yeah, right. Sure, there are many, many admissible completions. I don't know if there's a construction that would work for any group,
Or hyperbolic, there are some, yes.
If you have a, let's say,
If you have a finitely generated group, then you have a word length, and then you would look at the you would represent it on a L2, and then you would take the kind of differential operator that multiplies an element in the Hilbert space by the exponential of the word length and so on. And well, I mean, that you can look at the literature and the constructions of these things, but I mean, it's hard to define, hard to describe these words now. You need some formulas.
Okay, but the answer is affirmative. Yes, there is such construction for many, maybe not for every, but okay, thank you.
Tomek, unmute.
Sorry, I would like to continue Adam's question about Levitt path algebras. If you replace conjugation, the star structure, by adding this ghost arrows like this V in the construction of Teplitz algebra, can you complete it to something?
Could you say
that again? An analog of graph sister algebra?
You take a Levitt path algebra and you want to complete this?
In your presentation of your algebraic analog of the Teplitz algebra, you are using U and V, and there is no conjugation. There's no star.
There's no star operation.
So a similar thing you can do for arbitrary Levitt path algebra.
Oh yeah, of course, yeah.
So my question is anything known about these M analogs of graph sister algebras?
I mean, there is not a unique choice of an M algebra completion, but there is certainly a natural choice. I mean, which comes again from a kind of a word length functions and so on. But you can, there are many possible completions.
Do they have good properties like graph sister algebras?
Of course. I mean, for Levitt path algebras, you can basically repeat the arguments from sister algebras.
But I'm asking about M analogs.
M analog. So you can, I mean, it's easy to define an M analog, and using this M analog, you can compute its K theory and basically exactly the same arguments that you have for sister algebras. Mm-hmm. By the way, also in the purely algebraic Levitt algebras, you can repeat many of the computations for K theory from sister algebras.
Yeah, I know.
Like there are papers by Cortinas where he computes the K theory for Levitt path algebras, and he shows that up to homotopy equivalence, they are classified by the Bohn-Franks group. I mean, that's a K-theory computation and which comes directly from the same computation in sister algebras. I mean, it's very, very similar. I mean, from the graph algebras, the K-theoretic computations that you can do for sister algebras, basically they carry over to M algebras, or even more generally to the algebraic case.
Yeah.
All right, thank you.
But I'm very much puzzled by it. Could you give me some conceptual reason why this sort of miracle happens, and K-theory for Levitt path algebras under some mild assumptions is basically the same as for graph sister algebras? How come that it happens? I understand you can prove it, I understand you can compute it, I understand Cortinas did it, but if I am to explain it to a person on the street, what should I say?
Because you have this kind of AF sub algebra, well, I mean, which is just the inductive limit of matrix algebras. Uh-huh. So K-theory, you know how K-theory behaves for matrix algebras and for inductive limits, and uh-huh. that carries over to the algebraic case. And then you have basically a cross product by the integers also, mm-hmm. and that also carries over algebraic case. So you have you have Pimsner-Voiculescu theory sequence that carries over to the algebraic case. Mm-hmm.
because by the same, because Pimsner Boyculus could use a standard extension of the cost product, and that's completely algebraic, and you just have to apply if you have something like like exact sequences in your K theory in the algebraic case, you can do the same computation.
Okay, thank you so much. There is a question in the chat. Will the KK theory depend on how one views, for example, the case of Levitt-Pav algebras as an M algebra? But Alex, you can speak up. Why should I read it for you?
Yes, sorry. hello. So first of all, very nice talk. So I was curious about, like, I wanted to follow up on Thomas Mastic question, like if you start with a Levitt-Pav algebra, and I think like also like if you start with Grass, I mean, like you explained with the Bohr and Franks invariant, right? So you don't start with like, topological algebras, right? Like, and so how does like, I mean, like, is there like, does it depend on what kind of topological algebras one, like how one embeds those, for example? I mean, like Levitt-Pav algebras, like, I don't know, like, for example.
So what exactly is your question? I mean,
I'm also confused.
as far as I remember, like, sorry, like M algebras is like depends on like, it's like more general topological algebras, right? Like,
no, it's a locally convex algebra. I mean, I should say, I mean, all what I presented today also works with more general locally convex algebras. But then you have to replace the stabilization by the K. You have to replace it by stabilization by trace class operators.
Yes.
And then everything works just like here.
Exactly. And so how my question was like, if you start with a purely algebraic category, like say Levitt-Pav algebras, and like the way, like, I mean, like there might be several ways like to view them as a topological algebra, or as all of them as a category of topological algebras.
Yeah, that's sure. I mean, if you take just the very general locally convex algebras, then you can consider every algebra with a countable basis as a locally convex algebra. And it works, I mean, the theory works perfectly well for that case. So most of our algebras are finitely generated, right? So we have a finite set of generators, and then you take polynomials. And then if you don't complete, you have a countable basis, right? So you get an admissible locally convex algebra with a fine topology. So fine topology is the topology that you get when you allow all semi-norms. I mean, that's a locally convex algebra where the multiplication is continuous. And so everything I just said applies also to arbitrary complex algebras with a countable basis.
I see, yes. I see, yes. Okay, so that's why what you mentioned before with Bohr and Franks works so well, because in these cases, like one has like, yeah. I see, yeah, thank you.
Anybody else? I don't see any raised hands, all right. So in this case, I suggest we thank Joachim again. Yeah, thank you so much. This was a very nice talk. And I will stop recording right now. So thank you again. Thank you guys for coming. I stop recording.